Welcome to Korea and the World, a podcast on political, economic, and social issues from the perspective of the Korean Peninsula.
High-speed internet, smartphones, and mobile services are ubiquitous in South Korea. Not only does this make the country a technological frontrunner, it also shapes the everyday lives of its people. But what are the unique characteristics of mobile technology and culture in South Korea? Especially, how do children and the elderly interact with it? And what developments might we see in the future? In this episode, we talk to Damien Spry, who conducts research on South Korea's mobile phone culture. Damien Spry is assistant professor for media and communication at Hanyang University in Seoul. His research focuses on new media forms, mobile and social technology, and how the youth, as well as the elderly, interact with it. Professor Spry has published numerous texts in journals, books, and newspapers. He received his BA from the University of Adelaide, his MA from the University of Technology in Sydney, and his PhD from the University of Sydney. Professor Damien Spry, welcome to Korea and the World.
Thanks very much for having me.
What brought you from Australia to South Korea?
It's interesting, actually. It's a mixture of kind of like good luck and the way that the world's moving. Good luck, serendipity, really. I'm what's called a trailing spouse. I came here because my wife got a position here, so I followed her. And I was fortunate enough to be able to find a position doing what I love, which is teaching and researching digital media. But in another sense, it's kind of like the way that the world is moving, because there was this old cliche that in the 1990s, whatever the question was, the answer was the internet. So now we turn that into digital media. Then in the 2000s, didn't matter what the question was, the answer was China. But now let's call that Asia. So now, of course, doing research on Asia and digital media is what I should be doing. So I was very lucky to find myself here, and I've had a great time and learned a lot.
So was that just a pragmatic choice, or do you have an actual specific interest in mobile technology and especially its influence on the youth?
Oh, well, absolutely. My PhD looked at the use of mobile phones by children and young people, and specifically the policy responses to those uses. And my case studies for my doctoral thesis were on Australia and Japan, where I had spent quite a bit of time. But I'd also done a little bit of research and some publishing on South Korea before that, before I published my thesis while I was a doctoral student, and also had spent a little bit of time in Korea on invitation to talk about young people as digital media users. And comparatively between Australia and Japan and South Korea, it's quite interesting because there are some similarities, but also some things about South Korea that are quite different, quite unique.
South Korea has a reputation for the ubiquity of mobile technology and the role it plays in the everyday and social life of its citizens. To start off, is there anything special about the situation here in South Korea?
A lot of people will recognize similar forms of behavior here in South Korea as any other part of the world, except that there's this kind of intensity and dynamism that what goes on here. One of the first words that anyone coming to South Korea learns in Korean is bali bali, right? Which means quickly, quickly. So everything has to be done right now, right away, right? There's no point waiting. In fact, waiting is somehow wrong. So how that translates into how people use mobile phones is that, for example, I found myself being surprised when I'd be in a meeting with someone, the phone would ring and they'd pick it up and answer it right away and have like a 15-minute conversation before they got back to me in the meeting. At first, that struck me as being a little bit rude and off-putting, but it's quite typical here. And now I quite understand it. People will call and expect you to do things right away, and you're expected to be able to answer that call. So especially for workers, there's a kind of an expectation that they're always available, always being able to be contacted. But that's not only for workers, right? It's also for friendships, right? So friends expect their friends to be able to respond to them as soon as they can, either via call or, more commonly with younger people, via a messaging service. There's some other things that are quite intense about Korean mobile digital cultures. The politics online is pretty ferocious. So whenever there are, for example, political rumors, those things will spread like wildfire through social networking and messaging services. And they will then have an impact upon, old school media, whether that's TV or print. And very quickly, scandals can erupt, explode, and they'll require an instant response then from political leadership, which is kind of fascinating to watch. Sometimes a little bit troubling, because you do get the sense that people have to respond before they've had time to consider a position. And that's just two examples of the kind of intensity that's associated with digital and mobile media in South Korea.
How did this come about? I mean, just a few decades ago, Korea was considered to be a developing country, and now it's obviously not the case anymore. So how did that change so quickly?
Again, South Korea is an example of what a lot of countries have gone through, but at a heightened rate. So a few words like modernization, industrialization, and then this switch to the information economy, which most developed countries have gone through. South Korea has just gone through it at a far greater rate than just about any other developing country that you can think of. And now it's considered a developed country, of course. And in fact, it's ahead of the curve in a lot of ways. It's right at the top in terms of internet penetration, and probably at the top when it comes to internet speed. Sometimes Singapore tries to edge it out, but you know, there's not much difference between the two, if anything, right? So let's just say South Korea is number one, because that certainly would please the South Koreans. That's another thing, right? South Korea is very competitive. Inside South Korea, competition is fierce, but also South Korea is driven to succeed. You know, in the 60s and 70s, they needed to succeed because they were threatened, literally threatened, by the North. More recently, South Korea has been driven to succeed because it's been in competition at a global scale. So that's accounted for this kind of intensity that, again, which is associated with competitiveness in the marketplace, but also willingness to jump on in and grab a trend, for example, when it becomes available or becomes known. So if there's a new way of shopping or new way of chatting or new way of navigating, then you can sell that into a Korean market and Koreans will jump on it very, very quickly. And there are numerous examples of that, which I think we might go through. There are some kind of quirks in South Korean history that have made South Korea have to kind of respond in some of these ways. Obviously, in the 60s and 70s, as I said, it was North Korea. In the late 90s, it was the Asian financial crisis, after which South Korea had to turn around and say to itself, or ask itself, which areas do we need to improve in? And electronics and telecommunications was one of them. Democratization came late to South Korea also, late 80s. So throughout the 90s, you had a rapid form of democratization, which is closely associated with the opening up of certain forms of media, including digital media. And people really kind of like grabbed onto that idea of having a freer way of getting news and exchanging opinion. Having said that, what we might call legacy media, or the old school media, still is quite controlled a little bit by the South Korean government, which means there's an opening for social media as a way for exchanging ideas and getting news, as I said. So people really, really love that. It's a way of getting around the government, if you like. So there's a few reasons. There's a lot more. But yeah, generally speaking, South Korea has intensified its industrialization throughout that period because it kind of had to, and also it benefited greatly from it.
What specific steps has the government taken to really promote mobile technology and the internet in South Korea?
Well, setting up the network was a big one, all right? So setting up, first of all, the telecommunications network, and secondly, the high-speed internet network. South Korea is able to do this. In one way, it's easier to do it here because it has a large, relatively large population that's highly concentrated, especially in Seoul and its immediate surroundings. So if you take the greater area of Seoul, so Seoul and Gyeonggi province around it, you've got roughly half of South Korea's population kind of like mashed into a very small area. That means it's comparatively cheap, right, and comparatively easy to set up a very, very good communications network. So the government actually did that and set that up. And they saw that as one of the things that Korea could do in order to have some kind of strategic advantage when it's competing on a global level. So that's one area. It's also this strange attitude where it tries to support industries that are profitable and making money and therefore creating jobs and paying taxes on one hand, but also strangely has to try to take responsibility for some of the ways in which new media is associated with like social harms. And that's particularly associated with kids and young people as well. But I think we'll probably talk a little bit about that as we go on.
Surprising for foreigners who come to Korea for the first time is how different the internet looks. Just to give an example, in the Western world, let's say, Google would be the first website available. Yeah. But in Korea, the internet is not Google, it's Naver.
Yeah.
And this is not just for the internet. Mobile apps as well seem to be quite different. Instead of text messaging, Koreans seem to be very adept of using KakaoTalk, which is an alternative of other instant messaging apps such as WhatsApp. Do Koreans just like what's made in Korea, or is there some kind of story behind it?
It's fascinating, actually, and it's quite difficult to answer this simply. Certainly, the two dominant internet companies here in Korea are local companies, Naver for search and Kakao for messaging. And not only is Naver not Google, it's really different from Google. Like, Google is that classic, it just has the brand name and one place to put in your search term in there, and that's it. Most of the Google homepage is white space, and that's obviously deliberate. Naver has so much stuff on the front page that unless you firstly can read Korean, and secondly have time to try to navigate your way through all this stuff, it can be quite overwhelming. It's the same actually for Android phones. When you pick one up, there's, you know, three or four different message services, three or four different ways to buy applications or games and so on that are pre-installed on the phone. So that's something that's particular to a Korean market. More seems always to be better for people who are producing products for Korean digital media users. But how did this come about? That's itself very interesting. A lot of these companies, well, a lot of these ideas, like social networking sites, actually predate Facebook. People have been on social networking sites in Korea for longer than people have been on social networking sites in just about any other part of the world. Except those old social networking sites like SciWorld, for example, have now really kind of died away and are not that popular. And Facebook is actually very, very popular here. So you have this strange set of circumstances where if you want search or you want a map, you'll probably go to Naver. If you want messaging, you'll definitely use Kakao if you're messaging anyone else here. If you want to shop, there's a few different apps, but Kakao has one of those apps as well. If you want a taxi, the rest of the world is probably using Uber, or much of the world is using Uber. I know Uber has its problems in some places. Here, Uber has been more or less forcibly removed from the market, and Kakao has entered in its place and done quite well by doing that. But then some of the most popular social apps for particularly kind of like older teenagers and people in their 20s, like university students, are Facebook and Instagram, and YouTube is very popular here also. But again, Naver video is also very popular here, depending upon what you're using them for.
Are we seeing Korean local apps being slowly but surely superseded by foreign apps? You mentioned YouTube, but there's also Instagram, which seems to be incredibly popular. Facebook surpassed SciWorld. Is this a trend, or are there just exceptions?
It's too early to tell. I think for social networking, it looks like Facebook is going to, if not totally dominate, at least be a very big player here in Korea. Naver has their own social networking site, Naver Line, but the stats I've seen, it appears to be downloaded quite a lot. Facebook is downloaded roughly the same amount of times. Same amount of people are downloading Facebook and the Naver social networking site. But Facebook is used far more often and for a much longer time than is Naver. But Naver search dominates the local market. It's something between 80 and 90%. You can't really see that changing in a big hurry. And same with messaging. Kakao dominates again. It's like 80 to 90%. If you don't have Kakao in Korea, you probably won't be getting the messages that half of your friends are getting. But they're pretty simple services. And the question is, how do you make money out of those? And so we've already seen one very large company, Daum, which is also a search portal, first of all joining with Kakao and now kind of being taken over by Kakao. It's now called Kakao. It used to be, for a couple of months there, it was Daum Kakao. We've lost that company, all right? So that's one that's gone down there. Naver and Kakao are also kind of like in a fight with each other to dominate the mobile market, whether that's mobile shopping, mobile gaming. Kakao dominates that. Mobile shopping, it's a bit more of a fight. And also things like mobile banking and mobile payments, which they are considering to be the way of the future, the way they're going to make money. Is there room enough in a market the size of Korea's for both of those companies? I'm not sure. The other reason why I'm not sure is because outside of those companies, there are these huge other companies in Korea, which everyone refers to as the chaebol: Samsung, LG, Hyundai, SK, so on and so on and so on. They have not really been in the digital space yet. I don't know how much longer they can stay out of the digital space. Long-term strategic thinking for any of those chaebol would have to be to either partner with or buy, if they can now, or somehow, you know, get a foothold in that digital space. So that's a bit of a threat for them. On top of that, of course, you have the big globals. Who can take on, you know, Google, YouTube, Facebook, these guys? It's pretty tough.
Has the government actually let foreign companies come to Korea freely, or is there some kind of protectionism going on of the Korean companies, well, in favor of the Korean companies?
Typically, there is either a formal or informal set of barriers for most international companies coming into Korea in a lot of industries. And the digital space is, you know, it's a little bit like that. Part of this is, you know, as you suggested before, Korean companies do well because they understand the Korean market and how to sell to Korean consumers. So that's not really a barrier. That's kind of like a natural advantage that they have. But I mentioned before, you know, the problems that Uber had in trying to come into the Korean taxi market. Well, it faced significant challenges, both by organized labor, the taxi drivers and their supportive unions protested. They had a lot of political support. It was one of those occasions which happen with some frequency here in Korea where you get the sense that the Korean society and Korean politicians kind of shouldered arms against a foreign intruder. The Chaebol have benefited from that for a long time. I don't think that that explains Naver's success as search, for example. Google, to me, doesn't seem to be facing those types of barriers. I think that Naver just had an early adopter advantage. It got in there first and it established itself, and so therefore everyone uses Naver. Kakao, similarly. Kakao's story is interesting. You know, it doesn't stop others from coming in and introducing their own messenger services, but everyone uses Kakao, so no one else can really compete with that. There's a story about why everyone uses Kakao, which maybe we'll tell now, right? So this happened almost 3 years ago in the weekend that I arrived here, which was Chuseok weekend, which was, you know, kind of roughly speaking, Thanksgiving weekend. So it was late September, early October. And on that weekend, a lot of people spent some time with their families. They leave Seoul. And there was a game called Anipang, which was, you know, it was launched a little bit before Chuseok, but it suddenly took off. And on that weekend, so rumor has it, these figures are a little bit, you know, have to be wary about taking them at face values. But the reports were that on that weekend or over Chuseok week, something like 10 million people started playing this game, Anipang. Now, to play Anipang, you needed to sign onto a Kakao account. So suddenly, there were tens of millions of people who all had a Kakao account. And the other thing is that not only did you sign onto a Kakao account, you could see your friends' scores. So if you connected with other people using Kakao, you could see their scores, you could exchange life with them, you know, game lives with them. So part of the social aspects of gaming were included in that. And Korean gaming culture is very social, either competitive against one another scores or working together. So Kakao has dominated the messaging market since that weekend in 2012. Maybe Facebook Messenger will take them on eventually, but it would be remarkable.
A few months back, we spoke to investor Richard Min about the Korean startup ecosystem. Do you think that we might see the rise of a Korean equivalent to the Silicon Valley, and thereby a massive industry that churns out one mobile service after the other, or is that just unlikely to happen?
I think it's kind of happening, and it's a little bit below the radar. And unless you're an industry insider, it's kind of hard to see it happening. I don't think that there's going to be anything like the public display of creative energy and entrepreneurial enthusiasm that you get in Silicon Valley. But that's also because, you know, not many other parts of the world do entrepreneurism the same way as America does, right? It's kind of like big and loud and celebrated and a lot of fun in a lot of ways. Whereas in the Korean startup culture, I think will be more businesslike. It will be, as I said, focused on what insiders are doing, and they are doing it. What seems to be happening already is that the small startups are very quickly being bought out by some of the bigger fish. And eventually, those slightly bigger fish will probably be bought out by the even bigger fish. So I suspect that what we'll see in the long run is it'll all be kind of scooped up by Naver and Kakao if they can survive over the next 5 years. But that doesn't mean that there's anything bad for the startup culture. I mean, a lot of people who are working on a startup, they want to be bought, right? They'll work on something and they want to be bought at 6 months later. So what's happening now is you have companies like, there's one called Yellow Mobile, which is going around and grabbing smaller companies. So companies that are developing mobile financing software or mobile shopping software. So there might be, for example, an app that's really good at personalizing the types of shopping deals and shopping coupons that you want. And so Yellow will go and buy that. They'll buy up a bunch of these types of startups, and then they'll kind of refinance on the basis of it, and then they'll go and buy more. That's happening now. And one of the reasons why I think that will continue is because there's considerable political support for this, including attempts at both directly funding startup cultures and also encouraging companies to develop their own startup cultures. So some of the big companies, the Chable, for example, are setting up specific centres which are devoted to research and development to try and find ways of monetizing the new forms of digital media. Some of them are a little bit for show and not being that successful, but as long as there's enough interest in and support for a startup culture here, there is certainly amongst young Koreans lots of energy and drive and ideas. And I think one of the things that strikes me about Korea is how creative people between the ages of 20 and 40, really creative. They're looking at doing things differently. They see that the way that Korea developed, say from the 60s through to the 90s, is not the future that they necessarily are going to be a part of. To put it another way, Samsung Electronics used to be the most highly desirable job in South Korea. Now it's working at Naver. It's one report recently from a couple of months ago. So that's where you're seeing a switch being flicked from the old to the new. And startup culture is going to be part of that.
As you point out in one of your articles, the usage of cell phones among older generations is rapidly growing in South Korea. How come?
It's growing here in South Korea for the same reason that it's growing in some other countries that are also aging societies or age societies. So here we're talking about countries that include Japan, a lot of European countries, so places like, you know, Italy and some of the Scandinavian countries. There's two reasons for this. One is that people who have been using mobile phones for, say, the last 20 years, they're getting older. So they might have been, you know, 40 in the 80s when they got their first mobile phone as a professional. And now they might be only like 70 years old and they're still using a mobile phone, right? By the time you get to the 90s, just about most adults have a mobile phone. So then a lot of them are now retired. But there's a second group, which is people who have never used a mobile phone, let alone a smartphone before. And now they're finding themselves in a position where they can A, afford it, and B, that they kind of need it. And one of the reasons that they might need it is especially because they want to keep in touch with their grandchildren. In a place like Korea, a lot of people moved to Seoul in the last, say, 20 years. So that might mean that grandparents are back home in a smaller town or a smaller city where their kids and, of course, their grandkids might be here in Seoul or maybe at some distance from them. And, of course, they want to keep in touch with them. Their kids are all on smartphones or using social media or even email sometimes. And so in order to keep in touch with them, they have to. But they've also discovered that there are great advantages to having a smartphone. Just in terms of doing basic things like get around, you know, maps are incredibly useful, right, to, you know, find out where their friends are or just navigate the subway system or so on and so on. They've been able to do this because smartphone technology has developed so that it's become more intuitive, as we have seen over the last, especially over the last 10 years. So the interface is very easy. Pretty much, you know, you've got your finger on the screen now. You don't have to type anything in a lot of the time. Also, some companies, smartphone companies and telcos and some governments have recognized that older people might need a little bit of assistance, and they've been very willing to offer that assistance. So you get things like SK the telco here, which has been offering smartphone lessons for some of their older customers. There are some of the local council districts. One I visited in Yeongdeungpo, which, you know, is just south of the river, in between Gangnam and where the federal parliament is. So not a particularly wealthy part of Seoul, but not, you know, not poor, but certainly the people who are in this council area, they're not elite in any way, but in their council area they have a building that provides a whole bunch of services for older people, you know, so you can go see the doctor, get a haircut, take some classes in Chinese calligraphy, and also you can take classes in things like, interestingly, how to make a website, how to use a hand phone or a smartphone. So a hand phone was the word that's now rarely heard because it's just an ordinary mobile phone. And 2 years ago, the first time I went there, they were running classes for both hand phones and smartphones. They were cancelling the hand phone class because no one was going there. They had to double the number of smartphone classes, and they had to charge a nominal fee so that they could kind of like limit it to people who were really interested in it because it was massively oversubscribed. older Koreans are very enthusiastic smartphone users. They don't use it in the same way as younger people do. Typically, it will be call rather than text, and then use some basic stuff. Maps, as I said, were very important. Some basic web browsing, maybe some shopping, some things like that. But maybe older men, especially, watching baseball on the subway for sure.
Is this a trend that is specific to South Korea? Or would you say that South Korea is ahead of other Asian countries and the rest of the world?
It's probably ahead of a lot of the rest of the world. It's about on par with Japan. Japan is also an aged society. Technically, Japan's an aged society and one of the most aged societies in the world. And South Korea is an aging society, but the most rapidly aging society in the world. So it'll overtake Japan as an aged society in, you know, the next 10 or 15 years, I think. And similarly, the telcos in Japan have been developing devices which are designed for older people and also encouraging them through various government policies and programs to not only accept digital media and mobile media, but also recognize the benefits of it. And again, that's mostly about staying in touch with your family. Now, I know personally, that's also what's going on back in Australia with my family, and I suspect, in fact, I know, it's very similar in lots of other parts of Europe. It may be a little bit of ahead of the curve just because of the ubiquity of smartphones in Korea. They are relatively affordable here compared to some other places, and also because the network is so good, the internet speeds are so good, that it's so reliable that people have just, well, they start to expect that they can use their phones all the time. So, which is great if you, you know, want to talk to your granddaughter or whatever and you're on the subway. The other thing is, of course, people spend a lot of time on subways here compared to a lot of other parts of the world. It's similar in Tokyo. It might be similar in some of the big cities in Europe, like, you know, London, which have mass transit systems, you know, Paris. It might even be similar in New York. But you go to, like, most places in, say, like in the United States, people are more likely to be driving a car and less likely to be spending an hour on the subway, whether that's a commute to work or commute to go and see a friend and go bushwalking with them if you're an older Korean guy. All right, so that's a lot of downtime. And most of that downtime now is filled up using a smartphone.
On the other side of the demographic scale, young people and children are also part of Korea's mobile culture. Once again, is there anything specific about Korea in this case?
It's similar to some other cultures, again, including Japan, and similar to many developed countries, but again, more intense. Young people in Korea spend a lot of time online. There's a few reasons for that. I mentioned the lengthy commutes that they might have to go to either school or university, or if they're a little bit older, if they're going to work, or even to the Hagwon, which is, you know, the after-school study center, or if they're going to play sports. Everything takes a long time, to spending a long time on public transport. But even within the Korean home, and the Korean home is the place where most people will access the internet, even though they're accessing it on a portable device, like a smartphone or a tablet or a phablet. Korean homes will tend to be a little bit smaller, especially than, say, American homes or Australian homes and even European homes, which means that there is less private space. So the only way you can have a screen to yourself is to make sure that that screen is small enough that no one else can see it, and also that you can have the headphones in so no one else can listen to what you're listening to. So that means that young people who might, say, in an American home, be on a desktop computer while they're on a social network site, or even doing their homework, to be honest, in Korea are probably going to be on a smartphone. Now, interestingly, access to the internet starts very, very young here. I recently saw some statistics that looked at the ages of children between 3 years old and 9 years old, and it suggested that it was kind of up around 80% for that age group. Now, I hesitate to say that 80% of three-year-olds are on the internet, because that's a very wide range when you're talking about that stage of development. And also, you know, there's something about that figure that kind of like freaks me out just a little bit. But nevertheless, it's quite common for children, especially from the ages like six and up, to be doing things on, and including doing things online using smartphone, as well as doing things like playing games. From the ages of, say, 10 and up, so middle school, you're more or less expected to have a phone, if not a smartphone. And by the time you've finished high school, you know, it's very, very unusual for you not to have a smartphone. Now, that's similar to a lot of other developed countries, but I think it starts a little bit early, and the statistics about how much time people spend online are a little bit more. The other thing that's quite particular about South Korea, and this is a little bit different from Japan, as well as a little bit different to most other parts of the world, is that there is a strong sense of, say, like social cohesion. Your friendship groups and your family bonds are very strong, and there are high expectations that you will participate fully and immediately as much as you can in all kinds of social interactions. So how that relates is there's an expectation that you'll always be able to respond when someone reaches out to you, whether that be by text or a phone call. So that puts pressure on school kids to always be online. Other parts of the world, they might say that that happens there too, but here again, it's more intense.
So you mentioned that children between the age of 3 and 9 are already on the internet. Mm-hmm. That's obviously very young. But how do young children actually get to have cell phones? I mean, those are quite pricey, especially mm-hmm. in Korea, where most cell phones seems to be on the high end of the spectrum. They probably don't have any meetings or urgent mm-hmm. emails to send back. Why and how do they get their first cell phone?
Oh, most kids get their cell phones from their smartphones. Whatever phone they can, they get it from someone else in their family. They either borrow it from mum or dad if they're very young, or they get a hand-me-down from mum or dad or an older brother or sister when they get an upgrade. So, yeah, that's how they tend to get them. You're right, they don't have meetings in the middle of the night, but they do have, you know, friends that they regularly get in touch with, especially once after they start school, okay? So once they're preschoolers, although Korean preschoolers spend a lot of time in daycare from about the age of 2 onwards, so there may even be ways that they're communicating via social networks even in their preschool. I mean, it would be quite stunning, but it's not impossible to think of. But it's certainly by the time they get to elementary school, middle school especially, they are chatting to their friends about all sorts of things, including, you know, how to do their homework assignment, as well as what are their plans for the weekend. Those expectations of having a social identity, as any teenager will know, increase dramatically as you become, you know, as you become a teenager and go into high school life. And so therefore your friends become a little bit more important as your family becomes a little bit less important. So it becomes very important to solidify those ties with your peer groups. But another big reason for children to have either a mobile phone or a smartphone is so that their parents can contact them. In fact, my research has shown this, and it's true pretty much everywhere in the world, including here. The number one reason that a child will get their own phone first is because their parents will give it to them so that they can get in contact with them. Now, in a lot of parts of the world, that's because both parents are working. In Korea, it's not so often the case that both parents are working. Mum is often more likely to be a housewife, and her main role will be looking after the family. So that might make it maybe less important, you'd think, for her to be able to contact her kids via a phone. But in fact, no, because one of the things that's quite unique about South Korea is that after school finishes, there's a whole bunch of other things that kids have to do. You know, there is after school activities, there might be like, you know, band and sport. And then there's the big thing, which is the study group at the hagwon, right? Which everyone learns very quickly here. Most kids go to a hagwon, which is an after school study center. That can last up until 9 or even later at night. It's not supposed to, but it does last quite late. You can imagine your 12 or 14-year-old son or daughter finishing, wants to get picked up, or parents are just worried about them. They're trying to coordinate either a pickup or meals or those sorts of things. The smartphone becomes essential. There is no other way to do it. So that's why kids have mobile phones in the first instance. What they do with mobile phones afterwards is a lot of other things.
So as you mentioned, there are those two things happening. On the one hand, it seems to be a very social venue for the social life and development of the child. But on the other hand, it also seems very focused on the education and pragmatic reasons to have a cell phone. So let's try to first focus on the social aspect of it. In the West, we often associate the internet with cyberbullying, old men pretending to be little girls, a very dangerous space. Is that the case in Korea as well? And do those things happen?
Yeah, it certainly does. And it's become an increasing concern for a lot of people. And even most recently, one of the main concerns about how young people or how smartphones are being used in ways that affect young women in particular. So people may have heard of the expression upskirting, which is taking a photo up someone's skirt using a mobile phone or sometimes some other kind of very small, remotely activated camera. But most of the time it's using a phone with a camera that's part of it. Young women are typically the targets of this. It's not only old men or not only young men, it's men of all sorts of ages who are doing this. recently and quite disturbingly in South Korea, there was a report of a young woman who was taking footage of other young women when they were in the change rooms of a water park, so a recreation park, a theme park, and she was actually selling that to someone who had contacted her online. So there you get two, there's kind of like a double whammy there. The only way she would have met that potential buyer of that footage is through some kind of like social networking or messaging service. 20 years ago, it would have been impossible for those two people to be in touch. And secondly, the miniaturization of the phone means that they can't be everywhere, in fact, are everywhere, and can be used in a way that that's undetected. That was a massive scandal, and it's probably the biggest case of its kind that's been brought to light recently. It's not at all uncommon to be reminded of the fact that young women are concerned about this all the time. If you walk around the subways here in Seoul, especially in summer, where a lot of young women will wear quite short skirts, it gets hot in Seoul, so you know, who's going to blame them? But if you're going up and down stairs and escalators in the subways, and of course there is a risk that someone's going to be able to see up your skirt. So one of the things that you'll notice here, especially in summer, is that all young women will walk with carrying their handbag behind them to kind of like prevent anyone from, you know, invading their modesty. They're protecting their privacy. Quite a common thing to see is a constant reminder of kind of like the risks that they're being exposed to. But that's only kind of like one of the concerns that are raised about how young people are using smartphones and digital media. One of the big ones is, of course, internet addiction, which is being more often referred to nowadays as smartphone addiction. A variation of this is nomophobia, which is a fear of not having your mobile phone. Now, I have to preface these remarks by saying that unlike some in the field who have been doing their research on this, who come from a background of, say, psychology or some form of psychiatric medicine, I'm less inclined to actually call this an addiction, more inclined to call it a bad habit. What we're talking about here is people who are obsessive about their mobile phone use and feel uncomfortable when they don't have their mobile phone with them. An addiction seems to me to be something of a greater order. And it may well be happening. In fact, it probably does happen, but to a much lesser degree than is being kind of self-reported here by surveys of young people. But it has prompted a great number of concerns and even some policy responses. There is a lot of Korean government material online which talks about what you should do if you think your child is suffering from smartphone addiction. There are services that are available, even kind of tests that can be taken and kind of treatment services that are being offered. To the extent that these are being used by Korean people, it's quite difficult to tell, and my suspicions are that it is more important to be seen to address the problem for the government than it is for most people who just kind of like take it as granted as, yeah, I use my mobile phone way too much and I probably shouldn't be so anxious if I leave it at home. And there's a third concern that's been raised about use of mobile phones, which is that the accessing of inappropriate content online. Now, typically, if you're talking about young people, the type of content you're talking about is often sexually related content, so pornography. Well, we're talking about young men mostly using their smartphones to access pornography or, you know, some kind of like sites that they probably would be a little bit embarrassed if their mother knew that they were, you know, looking at. But it can also be accessing other types of content that's related to sites that may talk about things like suicide, which are a great concern here for young South Koreans. And young Koreans just talk about this stuff online rather than talking about it with their parents or their teachers or other adults who might help them. So what's happened is that in the last few months, an app called Smart Sheriff has been announced by the Korean government, and it's supposed to be pre-installed on every Android phone before it's sold now. Interestingly, iOS phones, in other words, iPhones, don't have this app made available. So that's one way that people are, you know, getting around it, if you like. The telecommunications companies, as I said, are supposed to pre-install the app for free, at no cost to the company either, to anyone under the age of 19 before they get their phone. To the extent that it's happening, I'm not sure, because I expect that we'll soon be hearing stories about young people finding their way around this app. In the past, there were apps that were designed to limit how smartphones could be used in schools. People got around that. So you can see that there's a pattern here. There are concerns that are raised about how smartphones are used by children and young people. There is a response, a political and public policy response. There's also a parental response to that that tries to limit smartphone use. But generally, either those limitations are circumvented by young people being just smart and finding their way around it, or families decide, no, I don't want to do this because, you know, this isn't the type of family we are. I don't want to monitor my child the whole time. Or sometimes it's just like, oh, I can't be bothered. I've got too many other things to worry about. They're fine.
So that takes care of external, let's say, dangers. But what about children-to-children interaction? Mm. It's such a dominant feature of a child's life. Does mobile technology supersede regular social interactions, just meeting in the halls and whatnot?
Mm.
Has that changed anything in the social lives of the children? Or is it just, instead of talking, we text?
It's changed it a little bit. I mean, it hasn't changed the fundamentals. People still have expectations about how they're going to communicate. They'll have issues about how they perceive themselves and how other people perceive themselves. And all of that is enacted online. But there's some really kind of interesting ways in which it's developed in an online space. Some of it's quite quirky. So, for example, for a while there, this is not happening anymore, I don't think, but for a while there, when young couples started dating, so a boy and a girl start dating, the girl would ask the boy for his smartphone and he would take a photo of her eye and she would make sure that that was the wallpaper on his smartphone so that she knew that she was always watching him, so he better not get up to anything that she wouldn't want him knowing about. In one way, that's kind of cute. Another way, it's kind of a little bit scary to think that, you know, she has those concerns and also that he has to be on that tighter leash. But there are other aspects of this that are a little more dangerous and a little less easy to laugh about, and that is the way that cyberbullying can get out of hand. And this happens in, you know, all over the world, but here I guess it is intensified, greatly intensified. There's a couple of things that feed into that, and they're not about the technology, they're about Korean society. Korean society, especially for young people, while they're in high school, trying to finish high school and get into the universities, is ultra competitive. It's really, really tough. Fortunately for them, their life gets a little bit easier once they start university, but during that period, they're expected to succeed. There's very little room between success and failure, put it that way. So if someone's not doing that well, that means they're especially vulnerable to anything that can make them feel bad about themselves. And South Korea, unfortunately, has a very high suicide rate amongst its young people. So things like cyberbullying can very quickly lead to increased suicide risk. The other thing that exasperates is that, you know, that idea that I've already mentioned, high expectations about sociality, what your friends think of you, especially a very tight-knit group of friends, is incredibly important. It seems a lot harder for Korean young people to kind of laugh off insults or say, I don't care what you think, or to try to claim an individual space than maybe it is in other cultures. And that makes cyberbullying worse as well.
So would you say that, well, maybe cell phones are a way for overworked children who, as you said, have to go to Hagwons, have to go from 6 a.m. to 11 p.m. from one school to the other to maintain a semblance of social life during especially high school years when there's nothing left to do?
That's exactly right. Social life and also a cultural life, which are closely joined together. So, for example, if you're busy studying, so therefore you can't watch the TV show that everyone's been talking about, what typically happens is that it'll be downloaded and watched either on YouTube or on Naver Video. But while you're watching it, you'll be chatting to your friends about it. So you can imagine, like a 14-year-old boy that I know, he's mad about football or soccer, depending on what you want to call it, right? So in his downtime, what he's doing is he's either watching live TV or recorded TV, which is competitive soccer, whether that's European leagues or the Korean leagues, or he's playing, you know, a game, soccer game, video game, and all that time he's talking to all his friends about that. Now, he's talking to his friends online because they don't live just around the corner, and by that stage it might be quite late at night, and, you know, his parents want him to stay at home and he has to be there for dinner and so on. So, but they're able to engage in those conversations with their friends about something that is quite important for them, you know. So I'm not one of those people who are flippant at all about the great value that young people find in having shared cultural experiences, whether that's, you know, talking about soccer or comedy program that people are talking about or a K-pop group that they love or a cooking show or whatever it is that they're into.
Being so omnipresent, doesn't it become problematic for learning? Of course, it helps coordinate the efforts at the family level, but in class, wouldn't all the children be on their cell phones instead of listening to the...
It's a major concern for educators, yeah, and I don't think they've completely sorted this one out. I mentioned briefly in one of the previous answers that there was some software that had been trialed, which was trying to geolocate children while they're in school. So what that means is that the software would apply only when the children were in a specific location, in this case within the classroom, and it could be turned on and off at any time. And when it was turned on, it would limit what smartphones could be used for. People are recognizing that smartphones can be used for educational purposes, and I do this all the time with my students. Quite frankly, it's a lot easier for them to carry a smartphone around in their backpacks the whole day than it is even a laptop. So if they're going to do some online searching or whatever it is, then they'll do that, use that on their smartphone. Now, these geolocated filtering software that was tried didn't really work. Sometimes students were able to kind of hack their way around it. Other times, what happened is that teachers forgot to switch it off, and it would last for hours after the students had left the school. So you can imagine, of course, the parents complained. And parents often want to get in touch with their kids throughout the day as well. Parents can be the culprits here. It could be them that's messaging their son or daughter during the middle of their maths class for whatever reason. You know, they're shopping for tonight's dinner. What do you want? That type of thing. So it's very ordinary, very prosaic, but it's profoundly annoying for the teachers. We've got to remember that this idea of the classroom of being a closed space where the teacher had complete control has only been around for about 100 years. For most of human existence, families have been in close contact with each other all of the time and have expected to be in close contact with each other. So it's a kind of a restoration of what happened before schools came along and made the outside world just stop and wait for a while, for better or worse, right?
In an article you wrote on the politics of childhood in Japan and Australia, you wrote that the extent to which public policy has been informed by the research thus far appears minimal, as archetypal attitudes about children and media predominate. Would you say the same thing also happens in South Korea when there's a discourse about security for the children or a measure to take?
Yeah, that's certainly the case also here in South Korea. And there are some reasons for that, the same as everywhere else in the world, that are related to kind of classic examples of modernity, that there are smaller families, children spend a lot more time being children, if you like, you know, before they're able to leave home, graduate, get a job, have their own family. That all happens later, which means that childhood is kind of like extended into a period where children are still kind of like partly children but are partly adult, and that's a very difficult period for them to navigate, but societies to navigate. Specifically here in Korea, there are some things about Korean families that are, you know, a little bit different and probably impact upon this as well. In a typical Korean family, as I mentioned before, there are great expectations upon children as far as their education is concerned. And it's a very competitive society. Korean families will invest heavily in their children's expectation. In return, they expect their children to perform, or at least they hope they will perform. That's seen as the way forward. That's seen as the way to be successful. And as I've mentioned, there's a fine line between success and failure. You either make it or you don't, and it's very hard to fit in the middle. The other thing is, you know, typical Korean families, older members in the family kind of can be quite demanding of family loyalty, perhaps more so than in some Western cultures, which means that there's less room for individualism, or it's kind of a little bit more difficult for children to have a voice of their own. They're expected to be part of their family and also part of their society, to be a part of a group. That means that it's possibly even more difficult for young people in South Korea than in places, say, for example, like Europe or the United States, to speak up and say, this is not what we want, to kind of like demand their rights, if you like. Children's rights are enshrined in various international agreements, and generally there's an understanding that children have certain rights to be protected and to be provided for. But there's a third aspect of children's rights, which is participation. And that's not as well recognized in most of the world, and I think in Korea maybe even a little bit less. Now, where that's different, where there might be a little escape clause, is in the digital space where people can be anonymous, they can be away from their family, even away from their friends. It's a place where if you are anonymous, you can be a little bit different, and it's okay. anonymity is a great boon for someone who doesn't really fit in. So that makes a digital space quite precious for some people. You know, for example, if you're a young homosexual person in Korea, it'd be very difficult to find a network that you could be a part of. But if it's anywhere, it's on that digital space. Unfortunately, that doesn't allow for young people to participate in any sense in the policy-making discourse. You know, I don't think laws are made after listening to the needs and concerns of young people in South Korea. And generally, they're not in other parts of the world either.
So in conclusion, would you say that the advent of mobile technology in South Korea has had, generally speaking, a positive or a negative effect on South Korean society and its youth?
In some ways, the question's a bit of a moot one because it's here and you can't get rid of it. It's not going to change, so you kind of have to make the best of it. But having said that, I've got to say that overwhelmingly, the benefits of social networking and access to information and all of those things that digital and mobile technology affords everyone these days is overwhelmingly beneficial. Not only economically, it's a massive market, it creates jobs, it creates wealth and so on and so on, but also socially in terms of enabling people who would otherwise find it impossible to stay in touch with one another, you know, find that it's very easy to do so, even at great distances. And also culturally, there's a great number of cultural products that are being developed specifically for digital and mobile media. And some of these are emerging only now. And I think we're going to be seeing a few more of these emerge in South Korea. And South Korea may be a place which is going to develop some interesting cultural products which will be able to export to other parts of the world.
Would you say, or would you see any new mobile trends on the horizon for Korea? What services, technology, fads would you expect to be the next thing?
Right now, the big things are mobile gaming and mobile financing and mobile shopping, all those sorts of things. Mobile advertising also is the biggest thing in advertising right now. So that's going to continue for a while and people are going to figure out how to get that stuff right and how to really make money from it. So that's where the industry is going. Culturally, as I mentioned, there are a few things that are coming from South Korea which are starting to be exported, for example, to the United States. Webtoons are a big thing here. So webtoons are simply cartoons that you access on the web and typically you get it from a smartphone. And they might be, you know, 2, 3, 4 panels and they might arrive, you know, more than once a day. So they're short, clip-focused pieces of entertainment. And some of them are beautifully designed, the artwork's extraordinary. Some of them are very poignant and beautiful stories. Naver is doing very well on this and they've started exporting them to the United States where eminent people in American comics like Stan Lee are starting to support that. So watch webtoons. The other thing is, of course, video and live video. So live video is very big here. It's starting to be a problem for television stations because fewer and fewer, especially younger people, are watching television, including things for like live sports. And most recently, live video of K-pop celebrities talking to their fans. So what you're seeing here is a bunch of K-pop stars in a room chatting away. They might have just finished a rehearsal or whatever. And while this is happening, the fans are interacting with them via forms of text. And then the K-pop stars are talking back to the people and saying, oh, thank you for your text, you're in. And a lot of them are from South Korea, but they're expanding this into especially other parts of Asia. So they'll be getting texts from, you know, from Indonesia or from the Philippines and especially China, Taiwan, so on and so on. So that's where mobile digital cultures are going. And that may be the next stage of the Korean wave, if you like. So the next aspect of Korean pop culture that could really take off overseas. And I hope it does because it's a lot of fun.
Professor Damien Spry, thank you very much for your time.
My pleasure. Thank you.
This was Korea and the World. To make sure you don't miss our next episode, bookmark our website, koreaandtheworld.org, subscribe to our podcast on iTunes, and follow us on Facebook and Twitter.